A cold beer is good. A cold boat is not. So let's talk about boat heating. Winter in Norway is cold and dark, and quite rainy if you live in the southwest. So if you want to continue sailing or spend any extended time on your boat, you need proper heating. This year I upgraded the heating here in my boat and I wanted to share with you what I learned. It took me quite some time to figure out how all of it works by myself, so maybe this video can help you to make sense of your system, avoid the problems I ran into in the installation, or give you some pointers on how to plan your next heating system. The heating in this boat was kind of broken from the day I got it. It was based on a 20-year-old Eberspächer 10 and it worked well sometimes. So I gave it to a service workshop and they ran some diagnostics. They found out that the electronics were fried. It was time for a new system. So I made some schematics of both, the old and the new one, which I'm going to use in this video. I will show them here, but if you want to take a closer look, you can download them as PDFs. Links are in the description below. Now, before we start with my specific case, let's take a quick look at what options are available and why I kept the central boat heating based on the water heater. Essentially, you have to decide what you want to heat up. Well, sure, the boat's interior, but either you heat up air or you heat up water, which then heats up air. Advantages of the air heater. They are obviously cheaper. The complexity of the installation is simpler and they can heat up the cabin quite fast. On the other hand, you need more space behind the panels since air ducts are generally bigger in diameter than water conduits. Air heaters only, as the name suggests, heat up air, and you still need to start the engine to get hot tap water. Then, for the central water heating, they are quite flexible in their usage. You can even use them to preheat your engine. In reverse, you can use a motor as a heating source for the cabin air, that is, if you install the heat exchanger or cycle the whole system through your engine. The water conduits are thinner in diameter than air ducts, but you always need two hoses to where you want to install a heater. They also tend to be quieter, and with multiple thermostats you can establish different heating zones, for example a lower temperature in the cabin than in the living area here. The ultimate argument for me to choose central water heating was that it allows me to get hot tap water without running the engine. If there's no electricity available or you are anchored up somewhere remote, I think it is quite annoying to start the engine if you just want to do your dishes or want to use some hot water to wash yourself. So maybe that argument helps you to explain to your partner why you paid so much money, because they are more expensive. You need more different parts for all the ins and outs and they need to work together. That increases the complexity of the system. Another con, the whole system is wet. That means you pump heated fluid through your boat instead of air. If something breaks along those conduits, you might have that fluid in your bilge and you need to clean up the mess. Last but not least, the heating effect of the water-based system kicks in slower. It takes some minutes until the volume of the heater fluid is on temperature and then you get warm air from your radiators. So, hot water on tap without running the engine. That was what convinced me to stay with the central heating solution. Let's take a look at how that works. That will make the diagrams later a bit easier to understand. But if you know all that, I made chapters in this video and by all means feel free to jump ahead. In essence, you start with some kind of medium that is heated up. Then this heated medium is pumped around in a closed loop or cycle to wherever you need it. Whenever the heating medium arrives somewhere where you need it, a heat exchanger is used to transfer it. The simplest form of that is a plain old radiator. More common are liquid-to-air heat exchangers like they are used in cars. They consist of a more compact radiator and a fan which blows air through it. The fan is controlled by a thermostat. If you need hot air, the fan runs, and if you don't, it doesn't. As for the hot tap water, the heating medium is routed through the water boiler. The heat exchanger in there heats up the tap water. Another form of heat exchanger can be installed at any place where you want to transfer heat from one cycle to another. The heating slash cooling mediums of both cycles are flowing in opposite directions close to each other through those and heat is transferred from the hotter medium to the cooler. The last vital part in the system is some kind of expansion tank. The heating medium expands and you need some space where it can expand too. Otherwise pressure might build up and your pipes burst. And then you have a cold boat and a mess in the bilge to clean up. Now, all those systems can be put together in a myriad of ways. Adding extra pumps, you can branch out into different heating circuits for greater controllability. But it adds additional complexity again, so my system is strictly serial. That means that all components are connected after each other in a line. A quick side note on how much power output the heating unit should have. It is a bit like asking how much horsepower an engine should have. It depends on your climate, the heating demand, insulation, etc., etc. So, with the basics out of the way, let me give you a quick overview over how my heating system looked like before the upgrade. It starts, of course, with the water heater, an Eberspächer Hydronic 10 and its pump. The unit and the fans were controlled through two switches, one for the heater and one for the fans with their thermostats. I will come back to why there is a second cable to the heater in just a second. Right after the water heater, the conduits forked into the expansion tank and the heat exchanger for the engine circuit. Then they merged again at an old hot water tank. That hot water tank was left in there from an old installation and the heating fluid was just flowing through. This one was not in any way connected to the tap water circuit. Took me quite some time and crawling around in the internals of the boat to figure that one out. It's just one of those problems you get if you get an old boat. Not everything is well documented. Anyhow, from there the heated fluid finally reaches the radiators or fans. Starting from the aft, through the living area, they run to the fore cabin. The cooled heating fluid is then returned to the heater and the cycle begins again. Remember what I said about the advantages of central water heating? You can get hot tap water without the engine? Yeah, the old system didn't have that. To get hot water, you have this second cycle here, where the engine coolant is first routed through the heat exchanger and then through the water boiler, which is actually connected to the tap water system. That cycle doesn't require a dedicated pump, since it is driven by the engine coolant pump. At least they used the heat exchanger to make the engine heat available to the radiators. That brings me again to the two switches. Let's assume the engine is running, but the heater is not. Well, then you have a coolant flow in this small engine circuit here, but not in that one. To get the fluid going around here, you obviously need to pump it around. Eberspächer anticipated that and they added an option to the older hydronics to activate just the pump of the unit. So the connection to the fan switch here starts the pump of the heating unit. Now you know how it looked like before and the drawbacks. Obviously this water tank here is redundant, it's just dead weight. Also, I really like hot tap water on cold days, so the water boiler needs to be integrated into the main circuit. I went to my local service guys here and they told me that there is no reason to fork out the expansion tank like this. They recommended to put it in series with everything else and to install it at the end of the circuit. The reasoning behind this is that since it is the highest point in the circuit, some heating energy gets lost through pumping it up there. Of course, we don't want that. After I made a plan on how I wanted to install everything, I got to work and started draining the system. I set to work at the heat exchanger, since it is one of the lowest points in the system and here most connections come together. I used standard tree plugs to seal the hoses, to avoid any dirt getting into them and to avoid heating fluid running out uncontrolled. Well, it was a mess anyways. Regardless of what you try, get a bunch of paper towels ready. You will spill fluid. And glycol is sticky. After some more draining and some cleaning, I saw that the heating fluid was brownish and rather milky instead of clear. I have no idea how long it sat in there and how often it was changed, but that looked suspiciously like some kind of rust or other corrosion. Long story short, I decided to take out the heat exchanger and to give it a thorough flush through all its ports. I used tap water until it came out clear. I did the same with radiators, but without detaching them from their interconnecting hoses. Luckily, a standard garden hose fits well into the conduits and can be held in place using the hose clamps. When the water returning from the radiators looked clear, it was time to reattach everything in the right order again. That brings us to how the new system is interconnected. Again, I made a diagram here. Originally, I made it just for me, so I didn't forget anything or get mixed up during the whole ordeal, but I think they turned out nice enough to share. So feel free to do with them whatever you want. Links are in the description. At first glance, it looks quite different. Forget for a moment about the electrical part down here to the left. It is actually quite simple and I come back to it in a minute. Everything is in series now. Starting from the new hydronic, the heated fluid passes through an air bleed valve I added for convenience, into the heat exchanger, the water heater for the tap water, the fans and finally the expansion tank. What is new is this auxiliary pump here, which returns the cooled down fluid to the heater. Also, the engine is only connected to the heat exchanger. Before it went through the tap water boiler, which, if failed, might have led to a failure of the engine cooling. A scenario I really don't want to think about. Anyways, that source of failure is now eliminated. So, why a second pump in the system? Well, the old Hydronic had an option to control the pump separately from the heating mechanism. The new one does not, which is not so obvious from the documentation, so if you do an upgrade from one version to the other, be aware of that. I've seen that Eberspächer has other models which are more tailored to marine applications, and here the pump is separate from the heater. It might be possible that they have this option, but since I wanted to keep it simple and just an upgrade from my old Hydronic, I went for this solution. So, how is the second pump controlled? If the motor is running and I just want the fluid to circulate, I use the fan switch as before. That connection runs through the relay here, and as long as the heater is not running, the auxiliary pump gets its 12 volts. As soon as the Hydronic is switched on, the relay opens up and the connection to the auxiliary pump is interrupted. To do this, I use the battery separator connection from the Hydronic. The battery separator line gives out 12 volts as long as the heater is running. After it is switched off, it has to run a bit, probably a cooldown program or something like that to prevent soot from building up. Again, not the best documentation. I found out by trial and error and measuring with a multimeter through several test runs of the unit. Now for the fun part, the installation and wiring everything up. But first, removing the old water tank. It's just dead weight and doesn't have any purpose anymore. Doing that, I found the most likely source of the rust in the system too. Onto the Hydronic itself. It came together with a prefab cable for the heater control and one for the diesel pump. I had planned to use the cables which were there already. Why making myself the extra work laying new ones? On top of the package, the new diesel pump. Nice and shiny compared to the old one. It was really just a one-to-one replacement. Same connector and everything. There was a relay in the box too. I used that one for the switching of the auxiliary pump. One of the first things I checked after unpacking was if the old mounting plate still fits. Fortunately it did, so that saved me quite some work. I could just use the old nuts and bolts and did not have to drill or glue anything new to the boat. Rerouting and reconnecting the hoses to the different parts, like the water tank, was quite easy. If they are too long, you can cut them easily with a knife. To get them to connect, you have to use some force if they are stiff. If it is really hard, some grease or WD-40 on the connectors does wonders. After reattaching the engine to the heat exchanger, I gave the engine a short run-up, just to be sure that there are no leaks in the engine coolant cycle. We all know that space comes at a premium in boats. Therefore, instead of mounting the heater directly, I first concentrated on the wiring. One thing I never could figure out is where the main fuse to the heater was located in my boat, but after taking a look at the prefab cable, I discovered that it had a little inline fuse box attached to it. So off you go for a wild goose chase along the already installed main power cable to find this fuse box. Guess what? I followed the cable from all the way aft to the main switchboard around midships. No fuse along the way. The old heater was hot wired to the battery bank. Whoever installed the old one did not think it might be a good idea to have a fuse for a diesel pumping and diesel burning machine in the boat. Adding insult to injury, it was hot wired to the battery side of the connector of an automatic fuse, which had the correct rating. When I think about it, maybe the old heater malfunctioned, the automatic fuse cut out because of the malfunction. And then some rocket surgeon thought, well, let's just connect it to the battery. It then continued to run, well, sort of. But that was ultimately the reason for the demise of its electronics. Anyways, all just speculation. Lesson learned, don't trust the wiring. So the cable back on the right connector and everything should be good here. After being done with all the wiring, another small bump in the road. They changed the diesel inlet for the new heater. Before it was below the unit, now it's from the top. So the connection box had to be moved out of the way and the diesel supply line lengthened by a few centimeters. Then it was finally the time for a test run, just to see that the unit and the wiring works properly. I filled the whole system again with the correct water glycol mixture and gave it a go. On the very first run, I found that air gets trapped above the heater. These water pumps really make a horrible sound when that happens. But well, they are actually rated to withstand it for some minutes. I think up to 30, so no damage done. Nevertheless, an air bleed valve was needed. After getting all the air out, it worked like a charm. You can see small wisps of smoke coming from the device, but that is expected. All the residue from production and fat from my fingers while handling it gets heated up and burns away. It didn't happen on subsequent runs. The heating fluid circulated, the fans fanned, and I got warm air. Everything worked out as intended. I also replaced the connection box. The old one was too cramped to fit the relay together with all the other connections. The new one is, I think, IP65 and has a rubber gasket. Not that I ever need it here. Hopefully. While digging around down there, I also found an even older part of a previous installation. An old calorifier to be used with shore power. All rusty, but luckily not connected to anything. The tank for the tap water fulfills this role now and has it integrated. So off it goes to make space for the auxiliary pump. The auxiliary pump arrived and it was only a matter of connecting it, checking for leaks and some more tests. It is only running when the heater is not, so I extended the same cable the heater uses for its power supply with a piggyback terminal and ample insulation. The pump also got its own fuse with a correct rating, in line and inside the connection box. The very last thing was to replace the exhaust. Cut to the right length, a pretty straightforward process, except if you're an idiot like me and put it in wrong the first time. Then you have to do it twice. And finally, closing up everything. Well, and throwing away all the trash. So I did a test run on an ice cold day. There was even some snow, so real world conditions. At the start of the test, the temperature in the whole boat was around 4 to 5 degrees Celsius. As a reference, I used the thermometer, which is hanging in the living area. The heater works now as intended. After the initial power heating phase, it cycled down. It stays then in the lower power settings to maintain its 70 degrees Celsius in the heating fluid. The only way to know which power mode the heater is in is by checking the sound the diesel pump makes. The speed of the pumping or clicking tells you the diesel demand. The faster, the higher the power setting. So, as you can see, it took almost 2 hours to heat up the whole boat 10 degrees. Well, at the point where the thermometer is installed. And to be fair, most of the heating happened in the first hour. I only measured one point in the boat and I also went out once or twice to double check for leaks. So it's not really a scientific test setting. And just that I don't forget about it, 10 minutes or so after starting the heater, I checked the tap water. Already then it had around 50 degrees Celsius. Hot enough to hurt anyways. So that really takes no time. A lot faster than heating by engine, where the whole engine block itself needs to get to a proper temperature first. But even for a central water heating, the air heating performance seems a tiny bit sluggish to me. I checked the temperature along the lines and it seems fine. The drop in temperature through the return line is only a few degrees. That, and that the heater switches quite fast into a low demand mode, suggests that the heater itself delivers more than enough heat. It is more a problem of the heat distribution, that is, the fans slash radiators are not able to keep up transferring the heat to the air. For now it works for me. It is quiet, once on temperature it is maintained nicely and the power consumption in terms of amperage is okay too. But if I ever wanted to have a quicker acting heating, I could install an additional radiator, defroster, fan, whatever you want to call it. Installing it now is easy, I just have to add it somewhere along the line. I even could add floor heating in the head if I wanted to. But this video is long enough as it is already. And right now there are other matters more pressing, so I'll keep that for another time. This was by far the most complex upgrade I did so far. Upgrading the autopilot and the navigation system doesn't even come close. That was only electrics. There were no sticky hot fluids involved. If you did watch this whole video thoroughly, you know probably 99% of what I do. It requires some planning and some basic understanding of electrics, and of course some spare time, especially if you don't know how your current system looks like. But once you know how you want to have it set up and made a plan, it's not that hard. So, I hope you liked the video. If you did, feel free to like and consider subscribing. If I forgot anything, you have further questions or anything to add, I'd be more than happy to receive your feedback in the comments. And with that, after all that work, I can go back to planning my next trip. And at least I don't have to freeze while doing it now.